Hello, I'm Associate Professor of General Hygiene Department of Sechenov University. The theme of our lecture is the influence of the most common physical factors, noise and vibration, to workers' health.
Industrial noise is a collection of sounds of varying intensity and diapason, randomly varying in time, arising in a production environment and have adverse impacts on the body. When operating a variety of equipment with riveting, pressing, working on machinery, transport, waves are generated. They are transmitted to the air and spread in it. The sound waves spread from source in the form of zones of condensation and dilution air. Mechanical oscillations are characterized by amplitude or intensity and frequency. The amplitude of the oscillation is determined by the scope and frequency by the number of complete oscillations per 1 second. A person perceived sound frequency from 20 to 20,000 Hz. The upper limit of frequency at which airborne sounds can be heard depends primarily on the condition of a person's hearing and on the intensity of the sound. For young adults, this upper limit is usually somewhere between 16,000 or 20,000 Hz. It's important, however, to realize that most people lose sensitivity to the higher frequency sounds as they grow older. The sound of frequency below 20 Hz is called infrasound. Above 20,000 Hz is ultrasound. When the sanitary estimation of noise, the intensity, power, and the spectral composition of the frequencies are measured. Even though the weakest sound pressure perceived as sound is a small quantity, the range of sound pressure perceived as sound is extremely large. The weakest sound that can be heard by a person with very good hearing is an extremely quiet location and is known as the threshold of hearing. The threshold of pain, or the greatest sound pressure that can be perceived without pain, is approximately 10 million times greater. It's therefore more convenient to use a relative scale of sound pressure rather than an absolute scale. For this purpose, the bell, a unit of measure in electrical communications engineering, is used. The decibel, abbreviated dB, is the preferred unit for measuring sound. 1 decibel is 1/10 of a bell and is the minimum difference in loudness that is usually perceptible. By definition, the decibel is a dimensionless unit used to express the logarithm of the ratio of a measured quantity to a reference quantity. Consider, for example, a large steaming hammer having a sound power of 1 watt, expressing this sound power in decibels. So, using the formula, it will be 120 decibels. If we calculate according to the formula the hearing threshold, it will be 0 decibels. The pain threshold is 140 decibels. Sound power cannot be measured directly. It's possible to measure intensity, but the instruments are expensive and must be used carefully. Under most conditions of sound radiation, sound intensity is proportional to the square of sound pressure. Sound pressure can be measured more easily. So, sound level meters are built to measure sound pressure level in decibels. The sound level meter directly indicates sound pressure level referent to a sound pressure of 20 micropascals, the approximate threshold of hearing. This slide shows examples of sound pressure and sound pressure level values for some typical sounds. Sound power is somewhat analogous to the power rating from the light bulb. A weak sound source would produce low sound levels, whereas a stronger sound source would produce higher sound levels. Sound power level is independent on the environmental surroundings. Sound pressure, on the other hand, is related to intensity and is analogous to the illumination produced by the light bulb. The magnitude of the sound pressure from a given sound source depends on the distance from the source. Although loudness depends primarily on sound pressure, it also affected by frequency. The reason for this is that the human ear is more sensitive to high frequency sound, that it is to low frequency sound. A complete physical description of sound must include its frequency spectrum, its overall sound pressure level, and the variation of both of these quantities over time. Loudness is a subjective human response to sound pressure and intensity. At any given frequency, loudness varies directly as sound pressure and intensity vary, but not in a simple straight line manner. A sound that have a constant sound pressure can be made to appear quieter or louder by changing its frequency. The physical characteristics of a sound, as measured by an instrument, and the noisiness of a sound as a subjective characteristic, might be a little relationship to one another. A sound level meter cannot distinguish between a pleasant sound or an unpleasant one. A human reaction is required to differentiate between a pleasant sound and a noise. There are different noise classifications. One of them is classification according to the noise etiology. According to this classification, noise may be aerodynamic, hydrodynamic, and metal. By frequency, a noise is divided into low frequent, mild range frequent, and high frequent. The last one is the most hazard for human health. By spectrum, noise is divided on wide band, a noise with a continuous spectrum width of more than one octave, and total noise with certain tones dominating the spectrum. A noise with the same intensity sound across all frequencies conventionally is referred to as white. By energy distribution and time, a noise is divided into steady state or continuous, intermittent or impulse. Continuous noise is normally defined as broadband noise of approximately constant level and spectrum to which an employee is exposed for a period of 8 hours per day and 40 hours per week. A large number of industrial operations fit into this class of noise exposure. Most damage risk criteria are written for this type of noise exposure because it is the easiest to define in terms of amplitude, frequency, content, and duration. Exposed to intermittent noise can be defined as exposure to a given broadband sound pressure level several times during a normal working day. The inspector or facility supervisor who periodically makes trips from a relatively quiet office into noisy production areas may be subjected to this type of noise. When the daily noise exposure is composite of two or more periods of noise exposure of different levels, the combined effect should be considered rather than the individual effect of it. Impact type noise or impulse noise is a sharp burst of sound such as whistle, horn, blacksmith's hammer blow, shot, etc. Sophisticated instrumentation is necessary to determine the peak levels for this type of noise. Noise types, other than steady ones, are commonly encountered. In general, sounds repeated more than once per second can be considered as steady. Impulsive or impact noise, such as that made by hammer blows or explosions, is generally less than 1/2 second in duration and does not repeat more often than once per second. Employees should not be exposed to impulsive or impact noise that exceeds a peak sound pressure level of 140 decibels. A noise causes the two types of effect on human body, specific and non-specific. One specific effect is professional hearing loss, maybe deafness. Mechanism of hearing loss is the development of atrophic processes in the nerve endings of the cochlear organ. It develops slowly and gradually progresses with age and experience. Noise-induced hearing loss usually affects both ears equally in the extent and degree of loss. And the second specific effect is acoustic trauma. Acoustic trauma denotes injury of the sensorineural elements of the inner ear and mechanical damage of the eardrum. Acoustic trauma is produced by one or a few exposures to sudden intense acoustic forms of energy resulting from blasts or explosions or by direct trauma to the head or ear. The worker should be able to relate the onset of hearing loss to one single incident. Non-specific effects are primarily the nervous and cardiovascular system disorders, with a predominant sustained vegetative disturbance. There are compliance of sleep disturbance and insomnia, headache, heart pain and palpitations, fatigue, memory loss, and irritability. There may be disorders of many systems, respiratory system, eyes, vestibular apparatus, gastrointestinal tract, cardiovascular system, and others. Among prevention measures, firstly, is the controlling sources of noise. For this purpose, meters of sound level are used. The degree of noise reduction required is determined by comparing the measured level with acceptable noise level. This level determines the sound level above which there may be hearing damage, deafness risk, and non-specific effects for an unprotected body, which is exposed for 8 hours per day. And compliance allowable noise dose. One dose of noise equals the influence of 85 decibels during 8 hours. To evaluate the noise exposure, for people working in locations where measurements in the center of the work area range from 80 to 92 decibel A, measurements should be made in each employee's normal workstation. If the level varies on a regular basis, both the maximum and minimum levels should be recorded. If the noise level never goes below 90 decibel A, unsatisfactory noise exposure is indicated. If the measured level is never greater than 85 decibel A, the noise exposure to which the employee is subjected can be regarded as satisfactory. Every noise problem can be broken down into three parts: a source that radiates sound energy, a path along which the sound energy travels, and a receiver, such as a human ear. The system approach to noise problem analysis and control assists in understanding both the problem and the changes that are necessary for noise reduction. If each part of the system, source, path, and receiver, is examined in detail, the overall problem is greatly simplified. The first group of prevention measures is the precluding the propagation, amplification, and reverberation of noise. For this purpose, the following measures are used: installation of machines on vibration dumping bases and foundations, and use of anti-vibration mountings. Separate installation of noisy machines to avoid noise propagation by other plant elements and of the premises. Complete or partial enclosure of noisy equipment, installation of sound barriers, sound absorbing linings, and sound isolating partitions. When premises are designed and laid out, the acoustic factor must be taken into account. Soundproofing of premises, lining on walls, partitions, floors, and ceilings with damping and absorbing materials. Another group of preventive measures is remote control and isolation. The remote control of the technological process must be used, and the process should be watched with the aid of a remote indicating displays. The equipment should be installed, if possible, in a separate room to reduce the number of workers liable to be exposed. There should be noise shields close to the workplace, which must be hermetically closed with air conditioning if necessary, or open on one side. And the last group includes the following measures: the wearing appropriate hearing protectors, rational combination of work and rest, and necessary preliminary and periodic medical examination. Pending the application of engineering control measures, employee exposure to noise can be reduced by the mandatory use of hearing protective devices. Occupational noise regulations require that whenever employees are exposed to excessive noise levels, feasible administrative or engineering controls should be used to reduce those levels. When these control measures cannot be completely accomplished, or while such controls are being initiated, personnel should be protected from the effects of excessive noise levels. Such protection can, in most cases, be provided by wearing suitable hearing protection devices. Once management has decided, then hearing protectors should be worn. The success of such a program depends largely on the method of initiation used and on the proper indoctrination of supervisory personnel and workers. Supervisors should set an example of wearing their hearing protectors when they go into noisy areas. So, headphones, antiphones, headsets reduce the penetration of noise in the ear by 10 to 50 decibels. Preliminary and periodic medical examinations must include audiometry and blood pressure measurement. Audiometry, or the measurement of hearing, is central to industrial hearing conversation program because all follow-up activities and program evaluations are based on such test results. An audiometer is required to help assess an individual's hearing ability. An audiometer is an electronic instrument that converts electrical energy into sound energy in precisely variable amounts. It should meet the standards. An audiometer consists of an oscillator, which produces fewer tones at predominant frequencies, an attenuator, which controls the intensity of the sound or tone produced, a presenter switch, and earphones, through which the person whose hearing is being tested hears the tone. There are many operations in which the exposure of employees to noise can be controlled administratively. For instance, production schedules can simply be changed or jobs rotated so that individual workers' exposure times are reduced. Employees can be transferred from job locations with high noise levels to job locations with lower ones, if this procedure would make the daily noise exposure acceptable. Administrative controls also include scheduling machine operating time so as to reduce the number of workers exposed to noise. For example, if an operation is performed during only 1 8-hour day per week, and the operator is overexposed on that one day, it might be possible to perform the operation in 2 half days of 2 hours each. The employee might then not be overexposed. Employees who are particularly susceptible to noise can be transferred and allowed to work in a less noisy area. Industrial vibration is the mechanical oscillatory motion of elastic bodies in the condition of production. It transmits directly to the human body or its parts and adverse impacts on the body. Sources of vibration are knock and friction of machine mechanism, inaccurately centered or badly balanced rotating masses, pressure pulses of compensated air, and so on. Vibration of according to the method of propagates in the human body is divided into general, it is vibration work, and local, at work with vibrogenerative tools. General or whole body vibration acts on the body of sitting or standing person through supporting surface. Sources are transport, for example, harvested pressure, tractors, lorries, train, machine, for example, weaving looms. Local vibration is mainly transmitted to the hands and arms. Sources are power-driven tools such as rock drill, chainsaw, portable grinders or polishers, settling and reverting hammer, pick hammer. Characteristics of vibration are amplitude variation in time and frequency distribution. If vibration is steady, then characteristics of vibration are velocity and logarithmic levels in octave bands. Hygienic evaluation of whole body vibration is produced in a range of frequencies from 1 to 63 Hz. Hygienic evaluation of local vibration is produced in a range of frequencies from 8 to 1000 Hz. Vibration is measured at the locations where the human body is in contact with the vibrating surface separately in each direction along X, Y, and Z axis. When local vibration of the handles or working elements of the When whole body vibration on the seat or usually standing point, working platform. There is a classification of vibration according to the frequency spectrum, taking into account the reaction of biological tissues and organs. Vibration has a strong biological effect. Despite the steady decline in occupational diseases, vibration disease continued to occupy a leading position. The effect of vibration depends on following factors: physical characteristics of the oscillating process, duration of contact between the human body and vibrating surfaces, and simultaneous exposure to other harmful factors such as cold, noise, static loads. When vibration propagates in the human body, the oscillations abound the more strongly the higher the frequency. But the damping factor doesn't depend on the intensity of the oscillations in the area of excitation. This explains also the differences in response to the action of low frequency and to high frequency vibration. The mechanical impedance of the vibration exposed hand is basically determined by the stiffness system. Any increase in muscular effort of the hand results in increased mechanical impedance. So the vibration conductivity augments as a function of increased stiffness of the hand. This is why the muscles are generally involved in causes of systemic exposure to low frequency vibration. When high frequency vibration, the zone of propagation is limited by the area of contact. The vibration power transmitted to the hand produces an elevated energy density in the soft tissues. It causes changes in the wall of the blood vessels. The intensity increases as a function of the frequency and is inversely proportional to the diameter of the vessel. Exposure to general vibration leads to resonance phenomena. In other words, to the increase of oscillation amplitude of the anatomic organ and system structure. General vibration affects in particular the central nervous system. It may be cause of disturbances of the neurohumoral regulation and metabolic process, dysfunction of various organs and systems, and increased energy losses of the organism. Exposure to high level of general vibration may result in damage to internal organs. Long-term vibration exposure is associated with vibration types of histological and biochemical alternations, leading to the dystrophic changes. Vibration affects the sensory systems, impairs visual, narrows the field of vision, diminishes the light sensitivity of the eye, and disturbs the vestibular function. Moreover, the effects of general vibration may cause general angiodystonia and a polyneuritic syndrome, the encephalic disorders, symptoms of microfocal lesions of the skin, hypothalamus region and hemisphere of the brain, peripheral neurovascular disorders of the upper and lower extremities. Special attention should be paid to the effect of general vibration on the female body. Prolonged exposure of women's body to vibration promotes occurrence significant changes in the part of female genitalia. Menstrual dysfunction, increasing the number of spontaneous abortions, prolonged changes in pelvic blood flow with the development of congestive phenomena. Now we consider symptoms of exposure to local vibration. First of all, it's a vascular syndrome, in other words, Raynaud's phenomenon, namely spasm of peripheral vessels. Symptoms of this syndrome are white finger after general or local body cooling, impaired sensitivity to vibration, to pain, to temperature, polyneuritic and angiodystonic syndromes, chronic lumbar sacral radiculitis. Vibration disease due to local vibration proceeds in several stages. The first stage is characterized by pain that may be felt occasionally, with periodic spells of paresthesia in the hands, a slight loss of vibration sensitivity of the fingertips. There is a propensity to arterial spasm. The second stage is stage of the moderately changes. For this stage, the typical symptoms are the pain and feeling of numbness. These symptoms are more persistent. The loss of sensitivity spreads to all fingers and to the forearms. The skin temperature of the fingers diminishes, and there are cyanosis and hyperhidrosis of the hands, and discrete functional deviations in the central nervous system. But at this stage, the changes are reversible. At the third stage, pronounced vasomotor and trophic disorders develop. The fingers become white, the hands are generally cold and moist, the fingers are odematous, all types of sensitivity of the hands are diminished. The muscular changes and the functional changes in the central nervous system are more pronounced. At the fourth stage, the changes become general. Vascular disorders can be observed in the arms and legs. The spasms may involve the cardiac and cerebral vessels, and the sensitivity is even more diminished. This phase is persistent and little reversible. The system of prevention measures include some standard groups. Firstly, legislative measures, standardization of vibration parameters. Since it's not possible to replace all vibration tools and machines, maximum permissible vibration parameters have been set up, and also weight of handheld machines, physical effort during work. Secondly, technical measures. In this case, there are automation and remote control, design of safe machines and tools by lowering the vibration parameters of the vibration sources. The next group is sanitary measures. They include, in this case, the maintaining tools and machines in a good technical condition by applying the standards of the preventive maintenance and the installation of anti-vibration bumpers for machines. Another group is organizational measures. It is organization of integrated teams of the master and related professions and organization of work regime. The work regime for jobs with general vibration includes the following measures. When working in a sitting position, a lunch break for at least 40 minutes and breaks of 5 to 10 minutes after each hour of work are recommended. Physical exercises are recommended in the breaks in the first half of the shift to change the static load to the dynamic load. In addition, self-massage of the back, arms, and legs are recommended in the second half of the shift to relieve static tension and normalize blood circulation. It's necessary to normalize the microclimate in the cabins for the prevention of cooling, especially the lumbar spine. Hot meals and beverages are advisable during breaks. It's necessary to create conditions for rest with the support of the head, arms, and legs, or lying down to rest and upload the spine. It's advisable to train workers in techniques of cell massage of the neck area and lower back, as well as industrial gymnastics to strengthen the skeletal muscle and maintain spinal flexibility. There is work regime for jobs with local vibration. The total working time in contact with handheld machines that cause vibration should not exceed 2/3 of the work shift. A momentary contact with handheld machine should not exceed 10 to 15 times. A lunch break of at least 40 minutes. Two additional breaks should be established for active recreation, carrying out production for gymnastics on a special complex and physiotherapeutic procedures. The first break is in 1 to 2 hours after the beginning of a shift for 20 minutes. The second break is in 2 hours after the lunch break for 30 minutes. And the last group is prophylactic and therapeutic measures that includes in particular personal protective equipment wearing. As a protection against local vibration, it's used gloves or gauntlets with a cock part on the palm. In case of exposure to general vibration, special shoes with the thick flexible soles are used. Then physiotherapy, special gymnastic, hydrotherapeutic procedures, hand baths for hands, massage and self-massage, ultraviolet radiation, diet therapy, the enrichment with vitamin B1. Prophylactic treatment under ambulatory conditions or in sanatoria. Great importance in timely removal from vibration exposure. When working with handheld tools is needed to avoid hypothermia of hands. Interruptions should be combined with rest in a warm place. Periodic medical examinations should be carried out. During the periodic medical examinations, the following laboratory tests must be performed. Radiography of the hand bones for those exposed to local vibration, radiography of the spinal column for those exposed to whole body vibration. Also, capillaroscopy must be included in the program of periodic medical examination. And also determination of skin temperature, vibration sensitivity, and pain sensitivity. The following specialists to take participate in the periodic medical examination. Otolaryngologist, neuropathologist, therapist, and if necessary, gynecologist and radiologist. This concludes our lecture. Thank you for your attention. Goodbye.